जय हिंद स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। स्टूडेंट्स, ऑलवेज स्टे ट्रू टू योरसेल्फ एंड नेवर लेट व्हाट समबडी एल्स सेज डिस्ट्रैक्ट यू फ्रॉम योर गोल्स। व्हाट आई मीन टू से इज दैट स्टूडेंट्स, हैव कॉन्फिडेंस इन योर ओन एबिलिटीज, डोंट लेट समवन टू डिस्पैरेज यू, राइट? सो अ केयरफुल अप्रोच विल मेक योर एक्टिविटीज लाइवली एंड डेफिनेटली रिवॉर्डिंग। सो बिलीव इन योरसेल्फ। With that positive note, students, let's begin today's session. Today, we are going to first discuss the principle of superposition, and then we'll be using this principle of superposition so as to solve some numericals based on this concept, right? So basically, if we have to find the resultant gravitational force acting on a particle due to number of other masses, then there we use the principle of superposition, right? Let me elaborate it. Let us consider this to a body of mass m, and there are several other bodies present around its vicinity or surroundings. Suppose this is mass m1. Let us consider this to be mass m2. Let us consider here to be mass m3. Suppose here it is ith mass mi, and let us consider this to be mass mn, nth mass, right? Now let us consider the distance between small m m1 is r1. Let us consider this distance between these two pair of bodies is r2. Similarly, let's consider this distance to be r3, this distance to be ri, and let us consider this distance to be rn, right, students? Our objective is to find out the net force acting on this body placed at point O due to the presence of all these masses m1, m2, m3, mi and mn, right? So in such a scenario, we'll make use of principle of superposition so as to determine the net force acting on the body of mass small m at point O, right? Now consider these two pair of bodies, isn't it? So this body will get attracted towards this body. This is suppose F1. Now obviously, gravitational force between the two bodies being action-reaction pair, therefore, this body will get also attracted towards this body of small mass m. But since here we need to find out the net force acting on this particular body, so we need to draw the vector diagram over here only, right? So I'm not drawing the vector diagram at these points. I'm drawing the vector diagram at a point in which the net force is to be calculated. Now if you consider these two bodies, small m and m2, right? So this body will get attracted to m2 along this direction. Gravitational force is a central force, so it will obviously act along the line joining the center of the two bodies. Now if you consider these two bodies, small m and m3, then it will get attracted towards this body. This is suppose F3 vector, isn't it? Similarly, it will also get attracted towards mi. It can be considered to be Fi vector. And lastly, it will get attracted towards mn. So this force may be represented by Fn vector. Right, students? So principle of superposition states that the net force, the resultant force acting at point O on mass small m due to the presence of all the other bodies is given by vector sum F1 vector plus F2 vector plus F3 vector plus Fn vector. So this is the principle of superposition of the bodies, right? It states that the resultant force acting on a body due to the presence of all the other bodies is given by the vector sum. It is the vector sum. Force is a vector quantity. So it is given by the vector sum of the forces exerted by the individual bodies on the given body, right? So this statement is known as principle of superposition. Now let us substitute the values and get an expression. So students, F1, it is the force existing between these two bodies. So it is in the vector form, it is G, M1, small m. These are the pair of masses, M1 and M, and distance between them is R1. So it will be R1 square, and it can be considered to be R1 cap. This is the unit vector, right? In the vector form, it will be represented like this, isn't it? Plus, what about F2? F2 is the force between these two masses, isn't it? So what will be the expression? G capital M2 small m. Small m is the mass which is placed at point O, where the net force is to be calculated using this principle of superposition. What's the distance between these two? It is R2. So R2 square. And the direction of F2 vector is along R2 cap, which is from small m to M2. Suppose it is like this. Similarly, students, due to this nth mass, the gravitational force would be given by G MN M divided by distance between these two is RN. So RN square. And direction would be along this one, RN cap. Right? Therefore, let's try to rearrange the terms. It will be given by G can be taken as common, M can be taken as common. So what you get is M1 divided by R1 square, R1 cap, plus M2 divided by R2 square, R2 cap, plus M3 divided by R3 square into R3 cap, and so on. Plus MN divided by RN square, RN cap. Isn't it? So we can write it in the summation form. So FR, it is equal to GM summation. I is equal to 1 to N. I is equal to 1 to N. And it can be written as MI divided by RI square. Right? And here RI cap. So if you initiate the value of I from 1 to N and expand the summation, you'll get the previous step. Right? In case I write I equals to 1, then it will be M1 R1 square R1 cap. Summation plus, then I, the value of I is to be taken as 2. It will be M2 divided by R2 square R2 cap. And similarly, we'll get the entire term inside the bracket. So this is the expression for the resultant force acting on the body of mass small m placed at point O due to the presence of all the other masses, right? So the assertion that each force acts independently and is not influenced by other bodies is called the principle of superposition, right? So 2 and 3 points are to be noted down. First is the resultant force. It is the resultant force is given by the vector sum. This is very important. It is given by the vector sum. So in numericals, we have to make use of laws of vector addition, force being a vector quantity. It is given by the vector sum of the individual forces. Exerted on the given body due to the presence of all the other bodies, right? Second is, students, each force acts independently, right? Each force acts independently. That is, the force acting between these two bodies is independent of the presence or absence of any other bodies, right? Third is, students, it is not influenced by other bodies. Each force is not influenced by other bodies, by the absence or presence of other bodies, by the absence or presence of other bodies. So these are the points which we conclude from the principle of superposition. Now students, we will try some numericals based on the principle of superposition. Let us try to attempt the first question. Three masses, each equal to m, are placed at the three corners of a square of side A. It's a square of side A, and the three masses, each of capital M, are placed at these three corners, right? Calculate the force of attraction on mass small m placed at the fourth corner. This is the fourth corner where mass small m is placed. Here we are supposed to find out the net force experienced by this body. So students, what to do is, let us first assign numbers on these four bodies. This is the body where the net force is to be calculated. Let us denote it by 0. And let the other bodies, we start with 1, 2 and 3. Right? Now students, what to do is, let's make use of the principle of superposition. Right? Now, due to these two bodies, it will experience a force along this direction, the gravitational force being of attractive nature. So it can be considered to be F01. Right? F01 suggests that it is the force existing between small m and capital M over here, right? Between point 0 and 1. Now you need to draw the vector diagram on the body or at that point where the net force is to be calculated. Here our objective is to calculate the force of attraction on mass small m. So this is the point where we need to draw the vector diagram, not at any other point, right? We are supposed to draw the vector diagram at a point where the net force is to be calculated. So we have considered this body, right? Now consider M2. Now this is the line joining small m and point 2. So it will get attracted towards this body as well. So this force would be F02 vector. Right? And if you consider this body placed at vertex 3. So for 0 and 3, the body of mass small m will also experience a force along this direction. It will be F03 vector. So we are supposed to find out the vector result of these three. That will give us the answer. Right? So what we do is, we know that F01 is equal to F03. Look students, the distance between these two and these two, it's same, each is equal to A, and the pair of masses is also same. So what will be the magnitude of F01 or F03? It would be G capital M small m divided by square of the distance. A is the distance, so it will be A square. Right? Now students, look, the resultant of F01 and F03, they are 90 degree, isn't it? They are inclined at angle 90 degree. So the resultant would be equal to, let me write it over here, resultant of F01 and F02 is, how much? It would be equal to root 2 G capital M small m divided by A square. How it has come? Let me elaborate you. Look, suppose this is F, each is equal to F, say. Now students, we are aware these two forces are at right angle to each other, isn't it? And both are of equal magnitude. So their resultant will bisect the angle between them. We are already aware of the Pallagram law of vector addition and all its important results, isn't it? So the resultant of these two, suppose it is F dash, it would be equal to square root of, if the two vectors are inclined at an angle of 90 degree, then resultant magnitude is given by square root of A square plus B square. So here, both the forces are of magnitude F. So it will be square root of F square plus F square. So it is equal to
root 2f. That is what I have written over here. Root 2 and f, it is equal to g capital M small m by a square. Right? So, this is the resultant of f01 and f03. Now look, what are the vectors we are left with? This is point 0, this is m, right? This is f02. And students, the resultant of this vector and this vector, that is f03 vector and 01 vector, is along this direction, that is f dash. Isn't it this one? Now these two vectors are in the same direction. Now we are aware, when the two vectors are in the same direction, they simply get added up. Therefore, net force acting on mass M is, these two are in the same direction, so they will get added up. So it will be equal to f dash plus f02, right? So what is f dash? F dash is root 2f, this one. That is root 2 g capital M small m divided by a square plus f02. f02 is the force between these two bodies, right? What will be the formula? It is g capital M small m divided by square of the distance between them. It's the diagonal of a square, and the distance between them is root 2a. A is the side of the square. And its square. Its square will give us root 2a whole square. It will give us 2a square. Clear, students? Therefore, resultant force is, you can take G capital M small m as common divided by a square. It can be also taken as common. So it will be equal to root 2 plus half. So students, this is the answer. This is the magnitude of the resultant force experienced by the body of mass small m placed on the fourth corner. Now what about the direction? It will be directed along 0, 2. Both are in the same direction, so the resultant will also be along the same direction, right? So, directed along 0 to 2, along this direction, 0 to 2, right, along the diagonal. So that's the complete answer, both magnitude as well as in direction, right? Let's concentrate on the second question now, students. Two stationary particles of masses m1 and m2 are at a distance small d apart. A third particle lying on the line joining the particles experiences no resultant gravitational force. We are supposed to find out the distance of this particle from M1. So let us represent this situation diagrammatically. This is body M1. Suppose there is another body M2, and they are separated by distance D. So this is the separation. It is given to be D. Right? Now a third particle lying on the line joining the particles. Third particle is supposed over here. Its mass is, let us consider to be small m, say, right? And here the net force is found to be 0. It do not experience any force. And its distance from M1 is to be calculated. If this distance is considered to be smaller, then the remaining distance would be equal to d minus smaller, isn't it? D is the total distance between M1 and M2. Clear? Now, it will experience a force along this direction due to mass M1. Let us consider it to be F1. It will also experience attractive force towards M2. Let us consider this to be F2. Now students, for net gravitational force or the net resultant force at this point, at point O, to be 0, these two forces must be oppositely directed as shown in the diagram, and they must also be of equal magnitude. So, for no resultant gravitational force on small m, F1, its magnitude, must be exactly equal to F2. So these two, being equal in magnitude and oppositely directed, will tend to get cancelled out. And that is when the net gravitational force experienced by this body of mass small m may be zero, right? So let's apply this condition and get the value of smaller in terms of d. So F1, it's the force between these two bodies. So what's the formula? Apply Newton's law of gravitation, g m1 small m divided by distance between them is r. So it will be r square. F2 is the force between these two bodies, right? So it is g. Pair of masses are m2 and small m. And the distance between them is d minus r. So therefore, it can be written like this also. D minus r divided by r whole square is equal to small m, small m get cancelled. We will be left with m2 divided by m1. Which further implies that taking square root on both the sides, we get d minus r by r is equal to square root of m2 divided by square root of m1. So this may be written as d by r minus 1, r by r is 1. It is equal to square root of m2 divided by square root of m1. Or students, d by r is equal to root m2 plus root m1 divided by root m1. When it goes from left hand side to right hand side, the sign will get changed, and then take LCM as square root of m1, and in the numerator will be left with root m2 plus root m1. Therefore, r is equal to, just cross multiply it, so r will be equal to root m1 divided by root m1 plus root m2 multiplied by d. So this is the answer. Right, students? So this body of mass small m should be placed at this distance from mass m1. Okay, students, now let us proceed to question number 3, which is an interesting question. What is the force acting on a mass 2m placed at the centroid G of the triangle when the three equal masses of m kg each are fixed at the vertices of an equilateral triangle ABC? This is an equilateral triangle. At each of its vertex, mass m is placed. Like this. This is mass m placed. And this is the centroid. Centroid means it is the intersection of the medians. It divides the median in the ratio of 2 is to 1. We all are aware of it, right? It is equidistant from the three vertices. So if this distance is r, it will be also r, it will be also r, right? Now, a mass of 2m is placed at the centroid. Here, mass 2m is placed. Right, students? So, we are supposed to find out the net force acting on this mass 2m due to the presence of these three masses placed at the vertices of an equilateral triangle. So, as I've stated earlier, students, here the net force is to be calculated. Let us denote it by 0. Let this be 1. Let this be 2. Let this be the third one, 3, right? Here the vector diagram needs to be drawn, because here the net force experienced by the mass 2m is to be calculated. Now consider these two masses. The force between these two will be independent of the presence or absence of the other bodies, isn't it? So let's consider these two masses. This is small m, this is 2m. So obviously gravitational force being attractive and central nature, it will act along this line. So this 2m will get attracted towards this m, right? So suppose it is F1. Similarly, students, if you consider these two pair of masses, then this one will get attracted towards that mass, isn't it? So let us consider it to be F2. And force being central, it will act along the line joining these two bodies. This body at the vertex will also experience equal and opposite force, but that vector need not be drawn, because our intention is to find out the net force at the centroid. So only the vector diagram at the centroid is to be drawn. Now students, these two masses are left, 2m and small m, placed at C vertex, right? So again it will experience an attractive force towards this body. Suppose it is F3. Now it's pretty clear the magnitude of F1 is equal to the magnitude of F2 is equal to the magnitude of F3 is equal to F, say. Let us represent it by F. And each being equal to, we are aware of the formula, isn't it? Between the two bodies of masses M1, M2, the gravitational force is given by F equals to G M1, M2 by R square. G is the universal gravitational constant. So over here, each would be equal to G. Pair of masses is same in all the three cases. One is 2M, the other one is M, isn't it? 2M, the other one is M. And the distance between each of these three pairs is same, that is small r, so it will be r square. So that is why the magnitude of F1, F2, F3 all are equal, right? And the angle between each of them is 120 degrees. So this is the vector diagram actually. This is F. This is F. And this is also F. All are equal vectors and inclined at an angle of 120 degree. Clear, students? Now, this is 120 degree. This is 120 degree. And this is also 120 degree. So, total angle becomes 360 degree. Now, students, look. Now, let's make use of the result directly. Now, there is no method in which all the three vectors can be solved simultaneously, right? At the same instant. So, the method is, first to solve any out of these three, let's consider any two given vectors. Let's consider these two vectors, this one and this one. Now, these two vectors are equal in magnitude and the angle between them is 120 degree. So, there's a special case which we have discussed while doing the topic of Palamon law of vector addition, that if the two vectors are of equal magnitude and the angle between them is 120 degree, then the resultant not only bisects the angle between them, but the magnitude of the resultant is equal to the magnitude of either of these two vectors, right? So what to do is, this is the third vector left, right? We'll draw the same way. It'll remain unchanged. Now we are going to find out the resultant of these two vectors, isn't it? This one and this one. So, they are inclined at 120 degree. So, their resultant would be bisecting the angle between them. Bisecting the angle between them means it will make an angle of 60 degree. Isn't it? It will make an angle of 60 degree with either of these two vectors. So, this is 60 degree. And this being 120 degree, so it will become a linear pair. It will be a straight line. And just now I have told you, if the two vectors are of equal magnitude and the angle between them is 120 degree, then the magnitude of the resultant is equal to the magnitude of either of these two vectors. So the resultant of these two vectors, it will have a magnitude equal to either of these two vectors. That is, it will have the magnitude same as that of these two vectors, right? So, now we are left with these two vectors. Both are of equal magnitude, but oppositely directed. So, resultant would be zero. They'll tend to get cancelled out. So students, the body placed at the centroid will not experience any force due to the presence of three identical bodies placed at the three vertices of the given equilateral triangle. Right? Okay, let's proceed with the last question then. What is the force acting on mass small m placed at one of the vertex of an equilateral triangle due to the presence of identical masses, each of mass small m, at the other two vertices of the triangle, right? Suppose this is the point B where the net force is to be calculated. The other two vertices also have identical masses placed at that point. So we can consider any one particular mass, right? We are supposed to find out the force acting on mass placed at any one of the three vertex. Let's consider this point. So again, let's number it. This is the point where the net force is to be calculated. So it is 0. Then we can start from 1, 2 and so on. Right? And let us consider the side of the equal triangle to be given. Suppose it is A, it's given, right? We are supposed to express the answer in terms of M and A. Now, due to this body at point B will experience a gravitational force along this direction. Suppose it is F1. Similarly, this body, under the influence of this body, will experience a gravitational force which, being central, will act along this line, right? Let us denote it by F2. And this being an equal triangle, each angle would be 60 degree. Now students, look. Here, the magnitude of F1 is equal to the magnitude of F2 is equal to FC. Each being equal to, pair of masses is same, and the distance between these two is also same, each being equal to A. So it will be equal to G, one of the masses M, the other one is also M, divided by square of the distance between them, that is A square. Right? So therefore, these two are equal vectors. I'll draw it over here. This is F and this is also F. And the angle between them is 60 degree. So students, we are aware, whenever the two vectors are of equal magnitude, then the resultant bisects the angle between them. So the resultant will make an angle of 60 degree with either of these two vectors. So this is the resultant. So direction we have obtained, it will be towards the centroid. This is the resultant force, isn't it? So what will be the direction of the resultant force? The resultant force will be directed towards the centroid of the equilateral triangle, right? Now let's find its magnitude. Now let's make use of analytical treatment of Palagon law of vector addition. Two vectors are F and F, isn't it? Both are of same. Therefore, the magnitude of the resultant would be equal to A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta. Here A, B both are equal to F. F square plus F square plus 2AB, that is 2F into F cos theta. Theta is the angle between these two vectors, which in this case is 60 degree. Cos 60 is half, isn't it? So what we get is F square plus F square is 2F square plus over here 2F square. Cos 60 is half. So this two get cancelled. 2F square plus F square is 3F square. So we'll get root 3F square. So resultant force would be equal to root 3F. That is root 3. We are already aware of the magnitude of F. That is G M square divided by A square. So students, this is the magnitude of the resultant force experienced by this mass. And you need to indicate the direction as well. So it is directed along 0 to G along the centroid. This is the direction which will make an angle of 30 degree with either of these two vectors, right? So students, I hope now you will feel confident in applying the principle of superposition in solving these type of questions, right? So that's it for this particular session. Keep practicing as much on as many numericals as possible. So do join me in my next video and keep watching my videos. And till then, I wish you all the very, very best and do take very good care of yourself. Thank you, students.